Hello, ako si Rambot Talabong at nanonood kayo ng Rappler Talk. Ngayong araw, uusapan natin ang pagpatay kay Jennifer Laude bilang isang hate crime. Matunog sa balita, ang usapan na ang pagpardon kay Scott Pemberton ay isang issue ng pagpabor ng gobyerno sa isang Amerikano kaysa sa isang kapwa Pilipino. Pero medyo nakakalimutan yung mismong story at saka yung usapan na ito'y kwento ng diskriminasyon kay Jennifer Laude bilang isang transgender woman. Na bilang Pilipino rin na transgender woman na kailangan nating pahalagahan ng kanyang buhay. Ngayong araw, ating kasama sa programa si Assistant Professor Andoy Evangelista, isang assistant professor sa University of the Philippines, Diliman, na nagtuturo ng sociology. Prof. Andoy, welcome sa program.
Maraming salamat. Thank you for inviting me to be part of this.
Bilang panimula, pwedeng ipaliwanag mo sa ating mga manonood kung ano yung ginagawa mo at paano ka napasama sa mismo movement ng LGBTQ rights dito sa Pilipinas.
Yung unang-una, I think na mahalaga ay yung aking self-identity and or self-identification. Ako ay isang bakla, lumaking bakla sa Pilipinas. And I use the word bakla for a very specific reason. Because hindi lang ako yung sexuality ko, ako din yung aking citizenship, ako din yung kung saan ako lumaking na bansa. Kaya napaka-importante para sa akin na ang identification ko, more than anything, ay bakla. At dahil doon, noong ako ay nagsimulang mag-pursue ng social sciences, sociology in particular, my research interest and my research projects has always been, always involved LGBTQ politics. So for example, for my master's thesis, I studied I investigated the history of the Philippine LGBTQ movement in the Philippines. So because of that, I have been very familiar with the dynamics of the movement.
Okay. Tapos, itong ano, medyo mainit pa rin balita, no? Ilang araw pala nakakalipas simula nung inanunsyo sa Twitter ni Foreign Affairs Secretary Teddy Boy Locsin. Ano yung reaction mo nung inanunsyo na pinardon si Scott Pemberton ni Pangulong Duterte?
I was shocked. I couldn't believe it. And then I started to read news articles, credible news articles, because I saw it first in a post. And then I said, is this really true? So I went online, I went to the different news outfit, and apparently it is true. And then I was shocked. I was really, really mortified. I think that's the word I could think of. I was mortified, not just because he was pardoned, but because I know that there are a lot of people in the list of who applied for pardon. And then as the events unraveled, I got more, you know, angry and angrier and angrier because one, we then later on discovered that no one applied for the pardon. Not his lawyers, not the US government, according to the Foreign Affairs Secretary. So it was solely, according to the news that I've read, the decision made by the president. So, and then that illuminated na lumiwanag na parang may mga bagay na hindi nasunod dun sa normal na kalakaran kung paano nag-a-apply ng pardon. So, yun, mortified. And then when the idea of GCTA, yung good conduct time allowance was used to credit yung years of served, I was also sad, and that's very unfortunate because the idea of GCPA, I think, is restorative justice. Yung idea na binibigyan mo ng panahon na mag-heal at magbago ang mga tao. I think that's very important as a value. But when it is used in this way, na-cheapen yung idea ng GCPA because you realize the inequity of how it is applied and how insensitive to the aggrieved party it was. Because as I understand, when I was reading the rules and the normal way pardon should be applied for, hinihingi yung comments ng aggrieved party, at least yung mga pamilya na naiwan niya. Kasi bahagi dapat ng restorative justice ay binibigyan mo ng hindi mo lang binibigyan ng pagkakataon yung isang convict na magbago, pero binibigyan mo rin dapat ng panahon at pagkakataon yung agreed party to heal themselves. Mm-hmm. And Merong mga interview yung family ni Jennifer Laude sa mga media, and you obviously see na hindi sila nabigyan ng pagkakataon to heal. There were no apologies, mm-hmm. there were no recognition that was a crime, at least from the convict. So I think napakahalaga. Mm-hmm.
Ano yung mensaheng pinaparating nito? Anong dumating na mensahe sa iyo nung pinardon si Scott Pemberton sa LGBTQ community? Ano yung mensaheng dumadating?
Right. I think meron ngayong sinatawag na konsepto sa queer studies. Ang konsepto na to ay and I'll explain it kasi medyo malalim siya, pero I'll explain it.
Go lang.
Homo-nationalism yung pangalan ng konsepto. Ang ibig sabihin ng homo-nationalism, from the 80s, when you know, queer lives or LGBT lives were excluded from the national imagination because the prevailing discourse at that time was, you know, queer equals death because of HIV/AIDS at that time. Mm-hmm. Sabi ng maraming queer scholars, nagkaroon ng transition. Nation states were able to fold in or include some queer rights, but then still exclude some queer rights. So dito makikita natin yung operation ng isang uri ng homo nationalism, kung saan binigyan nga ng hustisya sa umpisa, dahil although there are still I still have questions, and I think the law should learn from that decision that, you know, Pemberton was convicted of homicide only. But anyway, makikita natin na sa umpisa, parang merong surface level na pagtanggap. O sige, bibigyan ka namin ng hustisya.
Kasi na-convict si Pemberton.
Na-convict si Pemberton. Bahagi na kayo ng bansang Pilipinas. And then you see this, you realize that it is really a very volatile situation. It's very conditional acceptance. Na parang i-accept ka namin today, and then tomorrow, when the political interests have shifted, hindi ka na pala kasali ulit. So yun yung isang mensahe na para sa akin pinararating nito, na parang our acceptance is conditional.
So talagang, at the end of the day, nung kinonvict si Pemberton, ang dumadating, may karapatan naman pala, kaya naman pala makakuha, makakamit ng hustisya ng mga miyembro ng LGBT community. Pero ngayon, right, nagbago ng ang landscape, may coronavirus, medyo gipit ng gobyerno, tapos meron ng spekulasyon na gusto ng gobyerno ngayon ayusin ng relationship sa United States at sa ibang mga bansa para mauna kung meron mang vaccine na dumating. Tapos ngayon, mabilis ang pinardon. Pinaliwanag mo nga kanina yung proseso mismo na yung pag-pardon kay Pemberton, marami pa rin hindi nasasagot ang gobyerno. No? Okay. Yung mismong pagkatapos din ng anunsyo na pinardon si Pemberton, mainit din yung usapan na I think masakit to para sa mga miyembro ng LGBT community, na meron pa ring pagbintang kay Jennifer Laude kung bakit siya namatay, na tinago daw niya ang kanyang gender identity, kaya karapat dapat daw siyang patayin. O kaya rin siya namatay ay kasalanan din niya dahil tinago daw niya ang kanyang gender identity. Ano masasabi mo doon, Prof?
When you see I was reviewing for my master's thesis, I reviewed the court decision about Jennifer Laude. And there was a mitigating circumstance that Pemberton's lawyers argued for. Ibig sabihin ng mitigating circumstance, pinapababa niya yung sentensya. Hindi ba? At yung mitigating circumstance na yun, sa batas ang tawag doon ay obfuscation. In simple terms, nagdilim ang paningin. Ang argument was that when nung nakita niya na trans woman si Jennifer Laude, ay nagdilim ang paningin, napatay. Yun yung sinasabi ko kanina na merong lacking pa rin sa batas. Because we do not have hate crime laws in the Philippines, yung obfuscation is interpreted as a mitigating circumstance. Pero if we have properly defined what hate crime is, it could have been a litigating circumstance, because that means that killing someone is coming from a place of hate. And what hate crimes really does is not really criminalize murder. Murder is already criminalized. What defining hate crimes will do is that it will also criminalize hate on the basis of some irrational fear of the other. Mm-hmm. So yun yung
unpack lang natin yun, Prof. Mm-hmm. Unpack natin. So sinabi mo yung dun sa decision talaga ng korte, tinatanggap yung ideya na pwede kang magalit, pwedeng dumilim yung iyong paningin kung ang isang tao ay isang transgender. Tama ba? Pero kung meron tayo batas, kung meron sana tayong batas na pinagbabawal itong, hindi dapat naninilim yung paningin mo kung nalaman mo yung transgender isang tao. Dapat
or,
tanggapin mo.
Or kung nagdilim yung paningin mo, that should be part of the additional sentence to your crime. Because that, you know, or progressive queer activists like me, yung hate should be criminalized. It should not be coddled. Diba? Parang hindi mo pwedeng binibaby yung hater, hindi ba? So, yun yung sa batas. Pero also you see yung attitude, yung interpretation ko na yun sa batas, you will see that in social media discussion of how people are convinced that the trans women are liars or trans individuals are liars, right? Na sila ay sinungaling. I think hindi mo pwedeng sabihin na sinungaling dahil lahat tayo ay nagpe-perform. Lahat tayo, ang identity natin ay everyday pine-perform natin yan. And trans people are no different from us. And there are some things that you keep to yourself and there are some things that you don't keep to yourselves and you make it public. Does that mean then everybody deserves to die because some things you keep to yourself? Hindi ba? So parung yun yung isang implication nung argument na yon. But I am convinced that trans women or trans individuals are not liars. They're living their truth, the truest that they can be. There's a line in my favorite series, Pose. Sabi nung isang trans character, if you want to know the real me, that my genitals is the last thing that you need to look at. Because that's not me. That's the, yun yung, nagbumula kasi yon yung attitude na yon na sinungaling yung mga trans individuals. Nagsisimula yun dun sa valuation na ang identity ay laging nakakahon sa katawan. Mm-hmm. O nakakahon dun sa katawan na iniisip ng lipunan na dapat ay in-honor mo or whatever, or dapat you're true to. Truth to oneself is beyond the body. Yun yung masasabi ko dun.
At saka Prof, diba, kailangan din natin balikan na kahit anumang gawin ni Jennifer, kung sasabihin man ni Scott Pemberton na nagsinungaling ka o hindi mo sinabi yung iyong gender identity, hindi karapat-dapat na patayin ng isang tao dahil lang sa isang misunderstanding o sa hindi pagdi-disclose ng kanyang kasarian. Diba?
Right. Because nobody, everybody has the right to choose. Kanino ba ako magko-confide at kanino ako hindi magko-confide? And if you say that because you choose not to actively say it, one, nobody's asking, di ba? Wala namang nagtanong, di ba? If you actively choose not to, you deserve to die? That's, you know, hindi na right yung tingin natin doon kung ganun, hindi ba? Hindi na karapatan. So, what I'm trying to say is that, precisely how you put it, di ba? Assuming without conceding, I'm not saying that I concede na liar siya, di ba? Pero saying I don't believe that
assuming lang. He was a liar. Just to grant it.
Assuming without conceding that the argument is true, then does she deserve to die? Yun yung ultimate question that we have to ask these people who are saying this online.
Prof, pati kailangan din natin isa konteksto na binanggit mo nga na performative at tayo namimili kung ano yung pwede nating ibahagi sa ibang mga tao, pwede na, at tayo lahat naman yung meron tinatago at hindi sinasabi agad-agad. Pero sa mga transgender, hindi ganoon kadaling mag-open up, di ba? Kasi nga, nabubuhay tayo sa isang lipunan kung saan meron discrimination sa kanila at meron talagang kasaysayan ng violence sa kanila. Pwedeng ipaliwanag mo lang ito sa ating mga manunod kung bakit mahirap na sabihin agad-agad sa isang tao na, oh, transgender ako, na meron pa rin akong genitalia. Bakit mahirap yun para sa mga transgender?
Ang daming layers nun. Hindi lang kasi siya trans woman. She's a trans woman of color. So, in that case, ang daming layers nun. Kasi parang yung isang ang sinasabi nilang isang konsepto na ginagamit nila is may double stigma. Mas malala yung pinagdadaanan ng mga trans individuals kesa people who identify as gay or lesbian. Kasi sa kanila, doble. Hindi ba? May fear na ma-discriminate ka as a trans woman, tapos meron pa yung attitude na sinungaling sila. Diba? Yung attitude ng maraming tao sa Pilipinas na sinungaling sila. So napaka-importante or napaka-importanting mechanism, coping mechanism, yung being able to navigate your way through life if you are a trans woman. So napakahirap, tama ka, napakahirap na kasi ang daming sistemang panlipunan that is working against trans individuals. And therefore, it is not easy to say and shout to the world, hey, I'm a trans woman. And you know, we have some trans women who are courageous enough to do that, even in the movement. You know, the movement is filled with trans heroes and heroines. So, but in the everyday life of many trans women, napakahirap nun.
Okay. Professor, pati isang konteksto rin na kailangan natin pag-usapan ay hindi isolated case itong kay Jennifer Laude. Diba? Talagang merong history of violence against transgenders. Pwedeng ipaliwanag mo na kung bakit pati maraming history, bakit merong history of violence na kaagad sa mga transgender women at saka sa mga trans at saka LGBTQ community.
Right. If we're going to be historical about it, there are a lot of accounts about early Philippine societies. And when I say early Philippines, you know, before colonization, that mm-hmm. there were some parts of these islands where gender egalitarianism or yung gender fairness and gender equality was the norm. And it was the morality brought by yung term ng isa sa mga paborito kong scholar si Neil Garcia, he calls it mm-hmm. Mediterranean morality kasi galing sa Mediterranean yung mga Espanyol, hindi ba? Mm-hmm. So, because they brought that kind of morality, the first casualty actually of colonization is, or first of the, you know, many casualties of colonization were, one, women, and two, yung what they call at that time, bayut or bayugin, because they were then degraded into subhumans because of the morality brought by colonization. And it was only strengthened when the Americans came, when the Japanese came. So, in essence, what I'm trying to say is that there are historical roots to these kinds of attitude that we have inherited and we have, internalized through colonization. But what I'm saying is that they should not be treated as natural or native to us, because there are some communities before colonization where gender fairness is actually the norm. So, yun yung isang making sense of that attitude historically because of that colonial legacy.
Mm-hmm. So that's really a big thing to unpack, that we can never argue that we are naturally binary, because in the first place, historically, talagang tinatanggap natin lahat ng kasarian, di ba? Wala naman pati tayong konsepto na, ay, bayot ka, kailangan mas konti yung iyong karapatan. Kundi, tinatanggap natin sila lahat. At ngayon bilang ano, pagbabalik natin siguro sa isang lipunan na mas mapagtanggap sa mga tao ng ibang kasarian, nagbago na, gaano kalaki ang pagbabago simula nung pinatay si Jennifer Laude at ngayong araw na ito, maraming advancements sa queer rights. Merong mga rulings kung saan ni-recognize ang gay marriage. Tapos meron na rin diskurso sa online kung saan talagang kailangan tanggapin ang LGBT community, trans lives matter. Pero bakit meron pa rin usapan na ganito? Bakit meron pa rin discrimination sa atin?
Mm-hmm. Yung dalawang level, yung unang pagbabago na nakikita ko ay during that time, during the first, yung 2015, there was a sense that we were making strides, at least in public consciousness. There was a sense that, at least among activists of that time, I think may sense na parang malayo na yung narating from the early 90s, where, you know, nobody were really caring about the LGBT causes. And I think one of the things that changed is, at that time, there were homophobic people, but they were very silent and respectable about it. Now, if you see online, and probably because of the proliferation also of what Jonathan Ong and, nakalimutan ko yung co-author niya, who mm-hmm. calls the architects of disinformation,
yes,
dahil industriya na yon, people are out there. People are saying things that I could not even imagine they could say. Na, as if, you know, the person that they're talking about is subhuman. Mm-hmm. So, merong change on that I think was facilitated by, one, the anonymity promised by the architecture of disinformation, and of course, the economic and political interests embedded in the industry of trolling. So, I think yung isang pagbabago. Pero yung isa ding magandang pagbabago, may maganda namang pagbabago within the movement. During the beginning of the fight for Jennifer Laude, when it became a news, not everybody in the movement were calling out the colonial ties of the Philippines with the United States. Now, there are different unity statements from the movement, and people are beginning to realize the intersection of queer rights and the decolonization. Na parang hindi lang tayo dapat nakikibaka for queer rights, but at the same time, dapat nakikibaka din tayo para sa isang mas malayang Pilipinas from foreign interests. But at the same time, people who were already fighting against or fighting for freedom from foreign interests at the beginning, yung mga people who are progressive and left, are now also realizing we cannot just be fighting for independence for the Philippines. We have to also fight alongside that, fight for queer, LGBT, gender, and sexual rights. So I think this is a very momentous conjuncture in the history of the LGBT movement, because people are trying to find the intersections of issues rather than boxing issues from one another.
That's really interesting, Professor. And gusto kong balikan yung sinabi mo kanina. Sobrang interesting ito sa akin na in this disinformation infrastructure that we have online, and there's this hate economy going on where we're fighting right for clicks and nagva-viral lagi ang hate. Usually, madaling biktima dito ang mga LGBTQ community members, kasi nga, madali silang insultuhin, madali silang talagang i-target. Tapos ito rin mismo sinabi mo na itong entanglement nga ng issues na hindi pwedeng paghiwalayin ang queer issues sa historical issues natin where we have alleged imperialism at colonialism historically sa ating bansa. That's very interesting, yeah. Prof. But moving forward naman, ano kaya yung pwede pa natin gawin or ano pa yung pwedeng gawin ng ating bansa para mas maitulak ito at itaguyod pa ang karapatan ng mga LGBTQ community?
One, I think we have to learn how to hold our elected officials into account. We have a long way to go dun sa journey na yun. Napaka-importante na willing tayo to call out when they are not representing our interests. Many democracies, old democracies in the world, have figured this out to some extent. You know, for example, progressive organizations in the United States are willing to do that, call their senators, mm-hmm. call their congressmen, and then lobby for their interests. That's what we have to learn as a nation, as a citizenship. You know, the smart critical practice of citizenship. Because citizenship is not just, I'm a member of this nation. No, citizenship should be actively practiced. We have to, for example, on this issue of granting the pardon, we should be able to call out, you know, people who are complicit about that decision, right? Mm-hmm. For example, the biggest irony of this all is that Harry Roque, who is now silent, I don't know if he already said something about it, but he was part of Jennifer Laude's legal team. Mm-hmm. So we have to be able to call out people and say, hey, you're not representing us. The reason why we sent you to Congress, the reason why we sent you to the Senate, the reason why we sent you to the executive is because we want you to represent us. And that's on the part of the citizen. But on the part of politicians, they need to be open to this, to criticisms, right? There's a famous line, I forgot kung sinong actor yung nagsabi nun sa isang Oscars award. Sabi niya, sometimes the best way to support someone is to criticize. The problem with Philippine politics is that politicians always think of criticism as an attack against them personally. They cannot distinguish, or probably they can, but they don't want to. They have to listen to criticisms because that is democracy. And that's the only way I think we can move forward in a more progressive trajectory, especially in the context of LGBT rights.
Prof, ano yung systematic changes na nakikita mo? Kanina nabanggit mo na dapat meron tayong batas para i-penalize ang hate crimes. Bakit mahalagang meron ganitong batas at saka systematic changes?
Mahalaga yun to protect the rights of minorities. You know, I think it was in the... Dito haga, taal ito or native ito sa Philippine politics. I think it was the Magsaysay Credo that says those who have less in life should have more in law. And of course, at that time, in the 50s, the less in life was understood as poverty. But as we move forward in a more projective, progressive trajectory, we have come to realize that being less in life doesn't only mean being impoverished. It also means being denied the label morality, diba? Or being denied a God because of your sexual orientation, being denied an opportunity because of your gender, being denied access to a particular building because of your different ability, right? So, laws are there to protect especially the minorities. Having said that, we also have to have systemic change in the way we administer justice in the Philippines. The problem is we are so focused and obsessed on punitive. Parusahan, parusahan. I'm not questioning that. You need to have some kind of consequences to someone who transgressed someone else. But we don't mind the victims anymore, the aggrieved party. We don't have a program for their healing. So we have to combine these measures of consequences for the convict with programs, systematic programs that will heal the aggrieved party. And I don't know if people know about the documentary of Cherry Pie Picacci and Radical Love, but that was an individual effort to heal herself and, you know, make a peace with the perpetrator of her mother. But we have to find a way to systematize that, because the problem is that when, you know, the court decides on a sentence, then the family is left alone without any kind of support from the government to heal them. And I'm not talking about just money or monetary compensation. I'm talking about programs, counseling that will help them get through that loss.
Prof, these are really good ideas on moving forward, but there are always pushbacks that's being faced by the movement. And isa sa mga argumentong sinasabi, and this is actually everywhere around the world, na parang ayos na naman ang karapatan ng mga LGBTQ plus members. Lalo na sa Pilipinas, sinasabi nila na mabait naman ng mga Pilipinas sa mga bakla, di ba? Mabait naman tayo sa mga miyembro ng LGBTQ plus community. Ano masasabi mo doon? Nasapat na raw kung anong meron ngayong pagtrato sa mga LGBTQ plus members.
Then if that is true, why don't you legalize SOGI bill? Why don't you legalize marriage equality? You know, we still have much to do in law, as much as we have much to do in the public consciousness. If that is true, bakit may mga comments pa rin na sinungaling si Jennifer Laude or sinungaling yung mga trans sisters and brothers ko? Hindi ba? These comments prove that we are not there yet. And if there is some sense of acceptance, babalik ako dun sa sinabi kong konsepto kanina, napaka-conditional nun. If it only serves the interests of the powerful, and the moment that political interests shift, and there are more stake in taking another position, then one of the first casualties, along with many marginalized sectors, is the queer community, the LGBT community, because they can just toss us aside. Just like, you know, indigenous peoples, just like laborers, you know, something like that. So it might appear on the surface level that there are a lot of acceptance or tolerance, but that is very conditional. And this particular issue proves that when there was a shift already in the political interest, when political interest became when political interest became the interest of preparing, for example, relationship with an MP, you know, a colonial master, then it becomes easy for people to abandon queer rights or LGBT rights.
Tapos, Prof, punta tayo sa mga technicalities na nakikita rin nating pinocall out social media ng ating mga trans brothers and sisters, na yung mismong pag-describe din kay Jennifer, ano ba yung dapat na pag-describe sa kanya, yung tama? Sinasabi na trans siya, transsexual, transgender, bakla ba ding? Ano yung dapat na, ano yung tamang paraan na pag-usapan si Jennifer?
Right. One, nobody can decide how someone self-identifies. So we have to ask someone. But in this case, we have to ask people who are close to her, because obviously, diba, she was violently murdered. And people who are close to her are saying she identifies as a woman. And we have to respect that. And in fact, I would even go so far saying not only respect that, but accept that. We have to accept that she is a woman. As much as I identify as bakla and accept that, ako ay bakla, and she identifies as a woman. So therefore, we have to use markers for a woman, because that is how she saw and sensed her being, herself, right? So, the same way that if there is a cisgender man, or meaning, you know, a straight man, mm-hmm. that person would probably not want to be labeled as bakla, right? The same way with us, right? Mm-hmm. The same way with us. We don't want to be identified in such a way that we don't accept. And we have to not only respect, but accept that that is our right.
Really good explanation of representation and really recognizing it. Professor, ano naman yung ano masasabi mo at ano yung dapat gawin ng mga tao dito sa issue rin ng dead naming? Dead naming ay paggamit ng lumang pangalan ni Jennifer. At bakit mali ito? At ano dapat ang ating gawin ngayon?
Because Jennifer herself denounced that name, right? Of course, people will say, well, it's legal. But understand, what is legal is also constructed. Di ba? Yung pangalan na yon ang nagbigay sa kanya ay hindi siya. Di ba? And we have to, I think dapat isa din tong trajectory na systemic change. We have to have gender recognition law that will recognize the individual right to identify and say, this is my name and this is my gender, and this is my gender identity, right? That's one of the systemic things that we have to do. Na hindi lang SOGI mm-hmm. equality bill, we have to have a gender recognition law. So, dead naming is like dehumanizing. It's a kind of violence. It's a kind of symbolic violence because you are taking away the humanity of the person, the humanity that she sensed in her being. Tinatanggal mo sa kanya, hindi ba? So it's a violent act, you know. Sociologists will call it symbolic violence. Hindi siya physical na violence, pero tinatanggal mo yung pagkatao niya by not recognizing how she sends her being.
Pati ano rin, may init din sa usapang ito yung ano, di ba, merong trauma rin na nare-relieve ang ating mga trans brothers and sisters kung binabanggit yung luma nilang pangalan. Kaya talagang dapat din na rin banggitin yun kasi gusto talaga nilang kalimutan na.
Right.
That's looking at this in a broader lens, Professor, itong story ni Jennifer Laude, bakit mahalagang tandaan natin to? Bakit mahalagang paulit-ulit nating ikwento ang karanasan ni Jennifer Laude at yung mismong diskriminasyong nararanasan niya kahit ngayon?
Right. Napakahalaga nito, unang-una, dahil this is not just an attack to one trans woman. It was an attack. The night or the dawn that Jennifer Laude was violently and, you know, in unspeakable terms, was murdered, it was an attack to the entire, you know, LGBT community. Babalik tayo. Di ba yung paliwanag ni Jenny Pemberton? Obfuscation. Nagdilim yung nagalit siya dahil bahagi ng LGBT community si Jennifer Laude. And therefore, that attack was not just an attack on an individual. Of course, we have to recognize that. But inatake yung individual nung gabi na yon. But we have to also see that attack as an attack to the LGBT community. And this pardon, you know, already, you know, parang nagbuhos ka ng asin sa hindi pa naghihilom na suga sa isang komunidad. Hindi ba? So we have to always speak of these narratives. Not just this narrative, but the narratives of many trans women and LGBT individuals who have been violently assaulted. We have to continuously tell their stories. But particularly to this case, para sa diskusyon na to kay Jennifer Laude, I think yung unique contribution niya sa discussion is that it illustrated how important it is to look at queer rights and decolonization as two important and intersecting realms of struggle. Dito napakita na, wait, hindi lang siya pinatay dahil trans woman siya, pero dahil trans woman of color din siya, dahil Pilipino siya, dahil Indio or Indio siya. Hindi ba?
Tuhugin ko na, Prof. So, Prof, tuhugin ko na rin na isang mainit na sinasabi natin diskusyon at saka isang topic na sinasabi palagi ay trans rights or human rights. Pwedeng paki-unpack lang ito.
Napaka-importante noon kasi lagi ayan, sabihin na naman ng maraming tao katulad ng sinasabi nila sa Black Lives. Na ang pagsabi nila lagi, bakit Black Lives Matter lang? Di ba dapat All Lives Matter? As if when you say Black Lives Matter, it necessarily contradicts All Lives Matter. Diba? At yung argument na yun ay nanggaling sa isang paborito kong feminista, si Angela Davis. Sabi niya, when we say Black Lives Matter, we don't necessarily contradict the principle that all lives matter. We are just insisting that for so long, we have not cared with the marginalized, racialized community, and therefore we are insisting it. The same is true with trans women and trans men and LGBT in general. We have to constantly insist that because for the most part, people are always, it is easy for people to assault us, diba? In many ways, verbally, physically, to dehumanize us in many ways. Physically, merong tatay na binuhusan ng mainit na tumukulong tubig yung anak niyang bakla habang natutulog. May mga trans women na napapatay na hindi nalalaman weeks na yung binibilang nandun sa loob ng bahay at nabubulok na yung katawan. These are the things. And the other thing is, one of the first victims of the drug war, the supposed drug war, was a trans woman in Cebu. So we are insisting that because for the longest time, para kang ano eh, para yung may imbalance eh. Yung imbalance, sinasabi ng mga nasa taas, all lives matter, blah, 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 without recognizing that there's already an imbalance in society. Insisting that trans lives matter, particularly trans of color lives matter, is insisting that and is recognizing centuries of marginalization, centuries of inequality, and therefore we are just insisting it so that we can level the playing field. We can talk about all lives matter when we are all equal, right? But as long as there is inequality, we have to insist and side with the marginalized. And insist that they also too matter, right? Because every day, you know, people who are, you know, people in power, lagi naman, you know, every day, their lives matter, right? The same is true with Pride March. Bakit walang straight march? Eh, gugustuhin nyo ba na magkaroon ng straight march? Meaning, you would experience the same violence that the LGBT community is experiencing. The reason why there is Pride March is because kami lang naman yung may burden to stay in the closet, not a straight individual. Hindi ba? That's why we have to celebrate Pride. So you have to, ito yung mahirap intindihin eh. Kasi ang daling intindihin sa public discussion nung, hindi lahat na lang sama-sama. But what we have to always insist is that hindi tayo pantay-pantay nagsisimula. In terms of class, in terms of gender, in terms of sexual orientation, in terms of gender identity, in terms of ethnicity, race, hindi tayo lahat pantay-pantay ng starting line. And in order for us to get there, we have to constantly uplift the marginalized. And therefore, our cause should be centered around them. And not hindi mo palalabnawin na all lives or, you know, all gender matters or something.
It undermines the movement kung sinasabi mo na lahat tayo right. Naman kailangan ng karapatan.
Right.
Last question ko, Professor. Paano makakatulong ating mga manunod at lahat ng mga taong gusto tumulong? Paano itataguyod ang karapatan ng mga trans men and women at saka members of the LGBT community?
One, in the most practical everyday sense, you can start with your own circles, your own personal circles. Learn as much as you can. There are already available materials online you can read, you can watch, and then educate people in your circles. Right, that's the first realm that we can tap. Hindi naman kailangan lahat malaki. Hindi naman kailangan lahat nakikibaka sa kalsada or whatever. That would be nice if you will join us, di ba, in street parliamentarianism. But if you cannot do that, at least what you can do is start with your own circles. Educate your family, educate your parents, educate your brothers, your sisters, your friends, your cousins, right? It would be hard, but I think that is worthwhile, a worthwhile endeavor. Because eventually, mag-ripple effect yung mga yon, di ba?
And then moving out from that, kung ano yung next step?
Next step is yon, sinabi ko na kanina, be willing to call out your representatives. Remember, they are your representatives. They do not represent themselves in Congress, in the executive. They don't represent themselves. The idea of democracy is that they should represent us. And therefore, we must be willing to call them out. We must be willing to criticize them. We must be willing to point out what we don't agree with and what we agree with. Right?
Yeah. Well said, Professor Andoy. Thank you so much for speaking with us, Professor Andoy Evangelista of UP Diliman. Para sa ating mga manonood, sana mas naintindihan nyo yung kaso ni Jennifer Laude at kung bakit kailangan pa ulit-uliting ikwento ang buhay niya at kung bakit ang story ni Jennifer Laude ay isang story ng diskriminasyon na kailangang itama at kung bakit trans lives and trans rights are human rights. Maraming salamat sa panonood. Ako si Rambo Talabong.